to Storyboard, this is Shibani Gharat. As the chief brand officer of Procter & Gamble, world's biggest advertiser, you can easily say Marc Pritchard is one of the most powerful and influential person in the world of marketing. On his recent trip to India, we caught up with Marc and spoke to him about many things, including gender diversity and equality within his organization, the most recent Gillette controversy, and a piece of work that he's really proud of. Listen in. We are meeting on the sidelines of VC Equal. Tell us the whole idea and the concept of VC Equal, and when did P&G start seeing that equality?
Well, the VC Equal concept is all about our belief that there should be equality between women and men. There should be equal representation, equal voices, equal roles, equal pay, equal respect. And about 3 years ago, when our new CEO, David Taylor, came on board, he made citizenship a priority, of which gender equality is one of our main priorities. So from there, we created the VC Equal program, so to speak, and we've been using that ever since to be able to promote equality in everything we do, inside our walls and outside of our walls.
So exactly, how do you seamlessly include this in your advertising and in your day-to-day life?
Well, it's a good way to say that. We seamlessly build it into our business. And so how we build it into our daily life is within our walls, we look for an equal workforce. We want equal representation at every level of our company. We then work on programs to ensure that that happens. We also have great partnerships outside. So, for example, we have the Sesame partnership with Chomky and Gali Gali Sim Sim, which helps promote equality from the very earliest ages. Then what we do is build in equality into our advertising. We're really the world's largest advertiser with 65 brands around the world, so they touch 5 billion people every day. So what we make sure we do is have the accurate and really representative representation of women and in everything that we do. Take out all stereotyping, objectification, diminished character, and make sure we have an accurate and realistic portrayal. Yeah. And then periodically, will express a point of view, like Ariel Share the Load, which is one of our favorite.
Do you think it's a hard job? Because considering brands over the years have been known to build stereotypes across different markets.
Well, in fact, advertising has a huge impact on perceptions. One of the things that I ask people to do is go back and just Google objectification of women in advertising and see the images that you'll see from decades on. And ask yourself, have those images had an impact on how women are perceived? Absolutely, which is why we need to change that. The ANA hashtag See Her movement studied 40,000 ads, and what they found now that 29% still have some inaccurate or negative representation, either stereotype or objectification or diminished character. That must change. And that's why we use our voice in advertising to make sure we have the accurate representation.
You know, a couple of years back, in fact, when P&G had announced that, you know, it's going to stay away from stereotyping. And I remember that because I had to deliver a link to the camera on that day when the announcement and the press release came in. It is not really an overnight process. How did you build this over the years to not stereotype in your advertising?
Well, what we do is just make it a priority. We have training programs that we put, you know, boot camp, so to speak, within our own organization. We work with our advertising agencies, and we also have a score that we use from the See Her movement, which is called the gender equality measure. Yeah. You can literally measure whether the advertising is equal. And then it's become part of the way we do business. So now when you look at an ad, you ask yourself, is that an accurate representation? Is that a realistic portrayal? We also involve men. A big part of this is a program, it's called MARC, actually, which is a great name, Men Advocating for Real Change. That's just coincidental that it's MARC. But what it does is it gets men involved, so men are looking at the advertising, so men are doing what they can do inside the walls to be able to make sure that we promote equality.
So in your speech, in fact, you'd spoken about speaking to men. So how do you really do that? Because mostly FMCG companies across the world, when we hear them speak, they target she as the consumer. They always speak about she is our consumer. So how do you really talk to men?
Well, she is. Women are a major consumer, and so are men. women are half the population and men are half the population. Mm. So within all of our advertising, we want accuracy and realistic portrayals of both men and women.
Yeah.
And then on certain brands, what we like to do is make sure we can shine the light on men. So for example, one of our newest campaigns is Ariel's Sons Share the Load.
Yes.
Which I'm sure you've seen, which really makes it clear that sons can learn how to share the load when it comes to doing laundry. It built from the beginning that we did, with the one we started here a few years ago, with dad sharing the load. And then it just really has men thinking about things a little bit differently.
Yeah. You know, as a marketer, Mark, I wanted to ask you, what is the biggest challenge for you, which is, a challenge since the past couple of years?
Well, the biggest challenge for, I think, the marketing industry in general, and probably all business industry, is disruption. Pretty massive disruption that's occurring. The data and digital technology that's coming, that has come and that is going to exponentially increase, is disrupting media, it's disrupting advertising, it's disrupting how we work with agencies, mm-hmm. and it's disrupting the stories that we can tell mm-hmm. as well, which is why we use our voice for things like gender equality. So that's the biggest challenge. And what we're doing is we're choosing to constructively lead disruption. Mm-hmm. Changing the way we advertise, changing the way we do media to get more one-to-one, and using our voice in positive ways like we do with gender equality.
Over the past few years, I have seen many of the P&G's brands speaking about or taking up social issues. Mm-hmm. So why is, taking up social issues become so important for a company like P&G and for P&G's brands?
Well, what's really changed is the consumers we serve. 9 out of 10 people feel better about a brand if it promotes a positive promotion of a social or environmental cause. Mm. Half of people are making decisions on brands they buy on the basis of whether it shares their values. Mm. So that's a big part of it. The other piece of it is that business can be one of the greatest forces for good and a force for growth than any other organization in the world. So what we're doing is choosing to use our voice as a force for good and a force for growth.
Sticking to social issues, some topics that you take really work for brands. For example, Like a Girl really worked well. Everyone received it well. All the consumers really liked it. Mm-hmm. But something like Gillette didn't really go well with many sections of the audience. So what is your comment on that? How do you deal with that? How do you deal with the backlash?
Stay tuned. Always Like a Girl and Whisper Like a Girl, exactly right. 19% of people thought Like a Girl was a positive phrase before. 3 years later, 76% of people think it's a positive phrase. Gillette. Hmm. Gillette has had 110 million views in a little bit over than a month. What I would say is it's really important to discern between the actual consumer sentiment and some of the overheated social media rhetoric that has been reported. We have a lot of evidence that this is a very positive message and that there's been 3 separate studies that talk about how positive it is. We were getting thousands of positive affirmations for what we're doing. We've got schools that are educating people on it, companies and celebrities that are coming to talk with us about it. So I would stay tuned on this one because the social media rhetoric comes from a very small group of people. Mm. I strongly disagree with some who say that was an attack on masculinity. Actually, on the contrary, just watch the whole film. It rejects bad behavior and it promotes good behavior.
Yeah.
That's a good message and it's a conversation
that
needs to be had.
So, in an era of social media, how does a company, like a global company like P&G, deal with the backlash?
You just power through it. You really understand, and it's a very, very good question, you try to understand where is this backlash coming from and why is it coming from? We actually respect every point of view. So we're listening to every point of view. We really want to understand that. But as we understood it, we say, wait, this is coming from a small group of people who are getting disproportionately amplified. Okay, we will make sure we have a conversation with them. But then let's look at the rest of the folks and see what they're saying. And what we saw was that it was a much more positive response. Mm. So that's why we just keep going. And we keep having these conversations. It's
so,
part of leadership.
Sticking to this, I also wanted to ask you, because you run so many big global brands, how do you navigate these global brands across different markets specifically, keeping in mind the cultural nuances of, different places?
Yes, it's a good question, exactly the right question. We really try to understand the nuances in individual markets. Hmm. So what we try to understand, I'll give you a good example, is SK-II. SK-II has done work called Change Destiny. They've done some great work in China. where they focused on arranged marriages and how there are some women who are okay not being married. And they really changed attitudes with that one. Expiration date, which is an expectation that women achieve a certain age and they're expected to do things. And so they called it, it's an expiration date that they wear. They rejected that notion. Very powerful across all of Asia. What we've done here with Share the Load, I think, is another great example. We've really tried to capture what it's like to be in an Indian household and then be able to get the right nuances. And so it's very culturally relevant and very powerful.
Okay. If I were to ask you to pick your favorite piece of work from the P&G's table in the past few months or probably 1 year, what would that be?
Oh, my gosh. It's so
hard. And
why? Right now, I'm really loving Share the Load because it's such a powerful statement on Ariel, and Ariel's growing at a 30% rate. So it's really a business that is on fire. I'm also really love the Vicks Touch of Care work that they have done. They've changed the conversation around equality and around different intersectional equality. So those two, I think, are two of my favorites here from India. I love the SK2 work that they've done on Change Destiny. Olay, Fearless to Face Anything, is another great one. Secret has got some great work on equality. And I'm very proud of the Gillette work. I think it's groundbreaking work that will prove to be on the right side of history.
Okay, so you just named two Indian campaigns that you're really proud
yes.
of. What is the promise that, you know, India brings to P&G?
Oh my, India brings tremendous promise. We love this country, we've been in this market for many decades. The business is growing in our last quarter, growing in double digits. It's one of these markets where there's so much promise. The entire economy is coming on strong. You can see the transition that's happening in terms of data, digital technology. The consumers expect high quality products. Our strategy is very simple. We want to have irresistibly superior products, packages, communication, retail execution, and value. And the consumers in India will take all of that. And it's really been a very exciting market. And I think we're just getting started.
Okay. You know, in your speech, you mentioned technology for good. Mm-hmm. So I would say that the usage of something like AI, AR, and VR is limited to like a certain few niche products. Coming from someone like something like P&G, which is, you know, like all the products are mostly mass, how can technology be utilized or technology for good be used for the mass consumer?
Yeah, one of the things that has happened, I think technology over the past decade has really transformed the media and advertising world. What we're now starting to do is to use technology to embed in our everyday products. Mm-hmm. So we're actually thinking about how everyday products can be made better with technology. For example, an electric toothbrush with artificial intelligence that helps you precisely know exactly how you're brushing on your smartphone, that gives you information that you can use. How we have SK2 has a smart store, which is a store that is using artificial intelligence and other types of interaction to allow people to choose products without having any help.
Finally, in the coming days, what is the biggest change that we will see in the way in which P&G advertises?
Oh, the way in which P&G advertises. We are looking forward to where consumers actually completely welcome ads. So today, 7 out of 10 people say ads are annoying. We would like to eliminate that. And we would like it to the point where consumers really enjoy every ad. We think there may be situations where we pay people to watch ads. We think that we'll use a lot of the AR and VR, augmented reality, virtual reality, to really entertain people. So we're really looking at completely reinventing advertising.
Okay.
So it's a completely different experience.
So that the consumer enjoys it.
So the consumer enjoys it.
All
exactly.
Right. Thank All you right? so much. Thanks
okay.
for speaking to us.
Thank
Lovely
you.
Speaking to you.
It was great. Thank you, Shivani.
It is time for us to take a short break. On the other side of this break, we speak to Tarun Rai, Chairman and CEO of Wunderman Thompson South Asia, about his agency's new brand identity.